Hello everyone, this is Mamta Sharma from HR Support Foundation, and I'm delighted to bring to you yet another episode of True Talks, a special interview series about a deeper understanding of self and life. We have with us Nitin Shah, founder and director of HR and HR Support Foundation, to answer our questions today. Welcome to this episode of True Talks, Nitin.
Thank you, Mamta.
And welcome all of you to the sixth episode of True Talks, in which we are going to focus on forgiveness from others to self. If you have any questions or suggestions, please leave them in the comments below and we'll try to answer as we go along. You can also start a watch party on your Facebook accounts or pages to help other people benefit from this interview as well. So Nitin, yesterday's episode, we were talking about where what we can do with something in the past that we can get over. And you had told me that those are things that we need to let go of. But isn't it easier said than done? And so the real question is, how does one let go? Plus, I've also heard that letting go and forgiveness, kind of go hand in hand. So are they different? Are they same? And how do we actually let go and forgive?
So, Mamta, before we talk about letting go and forgiveness, let's talk about why letting go is important, right? Mm. And remember, you said that what if in the past something has happened because of which I am not able to let go of certain things, right? So, letting go is important because many a times we end up suppressing a lot of emotions. Mm-hmm. And we suppress those emotions. It so happens that those emotions over a period of time can start creating a lot of problems for us. Mm-hmm. Right? Have you ever come across a situation where people would tell you that my partner did something in the past, my partner has probably changed today, but yet I am not able to let go of that, I am not able to forgive them?
Yeah, so many times.
Yes? And so why is that happening right now? Why is the person getting bothered by it today while the event happened in the past?
Something may remind them, or maybe it keeps coming up and they keep fighting too hard to kind of shove it under the carpet.
So there are a couple of things. One, while the event took place in the past, the event had a major emotional component associated to it. And those emotions kind of get stuck in the system. Right?
Yes.
And because of that, we have a tendency to keep going back and replaying that event in our mind. And that's the reason why you will notice there are so many things that have happened in our life from the time we were conceived till today. But not everything from the past bothers us. There are certain things that our mind has a tendency to keep playing and replaying. And it's replaying those things because of those emotions that are stuck. Memory. Right? Now, so while I'm replaying it today, and that's where the problem is, yet those are emotions that got stuck from a past experience. And that's the reason why we need to be able to go back into a past experience and also be able to change that past experience and let go of whatever emotions were stored over there.
Oh, and how do you let that emotion go?
So there are multiple ways to let go of that emotion. If it's an emotion which is stuck in our system and those past experiences are not reoccurring, which means the event has taken place in the past, there is no chance of it happening again in future, and it's not ongoing right now, then simply doing a process where you are, remember we spoke about changing thoughts and emotions, and that I spoke about a process where you could breathe in and breathe out a particular color.
Yeah, yes, I remember that.
Right. We also spoke about how we can imagine blowing something into the balloon and then burst the balloon for effect.
Yes.
Right. There can also be a lot of cathartic activities that you can do. You could probably write a diary entry. You could probably go for an exercise. But anything basically which will help you make use of that stored energy, which is the emotion in this case, in an alternate way, which is more constructive for us, rather than letting it stored in our system.
Okay. That's interesting.
And so while this is true for events which are related to what is not ongoing in our life right now, right? But there are places where we are having situations which are ongoing.
Yeah.
In those situations, just letting go will not be enough.
Okay.
Okay. And letting go will not be enough because we will have a tendency to face the same set of situations over and over again.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
And if we have not learned to let go of not just the emotion, but also if you have not learned to understand how to deal with those situations better so that those situations don't repeat themselves in our life in future, then the possibility that we will sooner or later have a breakdown is very high.
Okay. Yeah, true.
Yes. Correct. And when I say breakdown, what do we really mean by breakdown? Can you think and tell me what does breakdown mean?
The closest thing that comes to mind is like a nervous breakdown. Somebody like probably crying uncontrollably, something like that.
So breakdown can be of two types. It can be a physical breakdown and it can also be an emotional breakdown, right?
Mm-hmm.
An emotional breakdown will be where someone on a very small thing ends up having a burst out.
Yeah,
or
right.
Starts crying alone.
Mm-hmm.
Right? On the other hand, a physical breakdown is where people start having physiological aches, pains, diseases, and so on. Where these diseases are more lifestyle or more stress related.
Oh, even that could be a result of pent up emotions.
So when people today talk about lifestyle diseases, stress related issues, what does stress mean? Stress is again kind of an energy stored in our system.
Right? So, yes.
In a way, it's the same thing as emotions. So before I talk to you about letting go and forgiveness, let's quickly talk about breakdown, because eventually what we are trying to prevent is a breakdown. Right? And that's the reason why letting go and forgiveness becomes important.
Okay.
Now, can you think and tell me why would we have a breakdown? Yes, obviously, apart from the fact that we are suppressing emotions, but anything that comes to mind, why do people have a breakdown?
So probably that suppression has come to a point that neither can I suppress it nor can I express it.
So even before we reach suppression, and what you're saying is to a large extent correct, but before we reach suppression, there are a couple of other things that are happening with us as humans. So generally, when we are in crisis, and crisis can be both physical and emotional, right? So whenever we are in crisis, as humans, we have two basic response systems. We either want to fight the situation or we want to flight the situation.
Yes.
Right? True. And obviously by fighting, I don't really mean that we want to go and slap someone. But by fighting, we actually mean that we are trying to face the situation so that we can work towards changing that situation.
Okay.
Right? And then there is the other part of it, which is the flight, where we are actually trying to put ourselves out of that situation so that we are no longer in a place where we feel we are in crisis.
So is it like avoiding or running away?
No. So it's not like avoiding or running away. It's literally like changing your, moving out of the situation altogether. So let's say if I were saying that I was having a crisis in my relationship, I may want to sit with my partner, talk to her, discuss with her and be able to face the situation in a way in which both of us are able to resolve the problem.
Okay. All right.
That is fighting. Okay. In the sense that we are talking about. And then the flight would be where I decide, you know what, I've tried everything, it's not working. And therefore, I'm better off just moving out of the relationship altogether. So I'm not, is it clear? I'm not really trying to, what we call as play dead. It's not that I'm in the relationship hoping that the relationship would improve by itself. But I'm really taking steps to put myself out of the relationship. That's a flight. Now, ideally, this is what generally we would want to do in a crisis-like situation. One of these two. But many a time, we don't really think either of them are possible. And that's
correct.
When we start playing dead.
Yep.
Can you think of situations in your life that you've played dead, or in the lives of people that you've worked with who have actually played dead?
Yeah, so for example, someone in a job that they hate, but they still keep going to office every day because either they can't find another job or... So they keep... they're not able to get out of the situation. They're not even able to improve the situation in any way. So would that be like playing dead?
Correct. So in case of a job, it's literally like someone who hates their job is not even working towards speaking to the boss so that they can get a transfer, nor are they trying to search for a different job. So it's neither fight and nor flight, right? They're continuing in the job, hoping that something would change by itself, which generally doesn't really happen. Now, because of this playing dead, what actually happens is that we end up experiencing a lot of emotions. And generally, we don't even find ourselves in a position to be able to express those emotions.
Right.
And then invariably, what we will end up doing is we will end up suppressing those emotions.
Yeah.
But when we are suppressing those emotions will need to be stored somewhere. They're energy in motion, right? They need to be stored somewhere. So that emotion gets stored in our body, and our body is like a sponge. It can only hold on to emotions to an extent. Beyond a point, the body says enough is enough. I can't handle this more than this.
True. Makes sense.
And that's where we start having a problem.
Physical breakdown.
Both. It can be a physical or an emotional. So in emotional breakdown, while I don't want to express, in a very small situation where I don't even feel there is a need to express, I'll end up bursting out.
Oh, yeah, right.
Right. So that's one of the things. And then they can obviously be physical breakdown where I'm literally having a health issue. I'm collapsing or I have psychosomatic aches and pains.
So then the solution would be to let go of that emotion, right?
Correct. Now, and this is the reason I wanted to share this breakdown cycle, because letting go of this emotion would be enough only if that situation where I'm not fighting or flighting is no longer a part of my environment, which means something happened in the past, I suppressed, the emotion got suppressed in my body, but eventually I was able to do something to resolve that problem. So now the problem is resolved, but the emotion is still stuck in. And that's the place where probably letting go of those emotions will be enough. But if that situation is an ongoing situation, then letting go is actually not enough. And this is one of the places where many of us make mistakes, including practicing therapists, where a lot of therapists believe that if we are able to help people vent out, if we can do catharsis, then that catharsis and venting out will help them get on with their life. That's not necessarily true, because the situation that the client is facing in their life or the situation that the person is facing in their life has not resolved. I can go, I can cry it out. I can make myself feel better. Right? Or I can talk to my therapist about it or my friend about it. When I go back home, I have the same father or the same boss who is bothering me, and I don't know how to deal with them.
Exactly.
Right? So what it does, letting go, if the problem is an ongoing problem, is it becomes like a painkiller. And what happens with the painkiller?
After a while, the effect will wear off and you'll be back to square one.
Correct. And you need more and more of it.
Yes. And you may become dependent on it.
Correct. And have you noticed this is what happens with a lot of people? Some of your friends who would generally complain about their relationships, they would have started complaining probably once in 6 months. Then they started complaining once every month. Now they may have reached a place where every time you talk to them, they complain.
They only want to talk about that one thing.
Correct. Because that's the only thing that's helping them let go of whatever those emotions are which are suppressed. But the effectiveness of that letting go by talking to a friend is going down drastically, because it's, again, as I said, it's like a painkiller. Right? And therefore, when we talk about all of these things, and there are... these techniques of letting go are useful, to, like I mentioned, to do a diary entry or to be able to talk to a friend or to be able to even at times go for a meditation or a relaxation process where you are releasing those emotions. Right? They are useful, but only if those situations are no longer a part of your life. Otherwise, you need to still work with managing your thoughts, your emotions, and developing skills to be able to handle those situations.
But in the third, so I was saying when you know, like I have heard and I've seen like people going to meditations where there's catharsis, they cry, they feel lighter. But in all those cases, they are not really developing any skill. It is just like a momentary relief. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. In fact, a lot of people that you will find around you, you will notice that, especially when I spoke about meditation, there are people who got addicted to certain kinds of meditations. You will notice they will tell you that unless I get up in the morning and I do that meditation, my entire day goes for a toss.
And in fact, many would even say that, you know, earlier I could do it for 15 minutes. Now I can do it for half an hour. And now I can do it for 45 minutes. So.
Correct. So while they are doing meditation for a longer period of time, their ability to handle the problem is not really improving in that thing. Correct. And now, while they are able to meditate longer, if they are able to, that still is not helping them. In many ways, there also is a possibility that they're getting addicted to that meditation.
Yeah. In fact, I probably know a couple of people who would fall into that category. So, channelizing your energy will give you that resolution?
Channelizing your energy will give you that resolution. Again, as I said, channelizing will give you that resolution only if that situation is over. Unless you develop the skills and the mental state to be able to handle that situation and resolve that situation, everything else that we are talking about will remain incomplete.
Oh, and for the skills, you again go back to a plan of action. Am I right?
For skills, you go back to the plan of action. Correct. So for skills, as you mentioned during the goal setting episode, developing that skill becomes like a goal. And then anything that's coming in the way of helping you develop that skill will go as a part of your task list or will go as a part of your managing emotional and mental state. But see, remember when we are talking about letting go, here also we are talking about managing mental and emotional state. Right?
True.
But the difference is this mental and emotional state is more coming from the past. And what we discussed over there in that particular episode was more about helping you deal with things that you were facing on an ongoing basis because of specific triggers that you had in your life.
Correct. So how do you deal with that?
Deal with what?
So mental state, which is related to things coming from the past.
And what I said exactly the same thing, that we are actually looking at letting go of those emotions through the different processes we spoke about and then developing the right skill and the state to be able to manage that situation so that the situation doesn't repeat by itself.
All right. Correct. Makes sense. So, Nitin, coming back to the meditation bit that we were talking about, I've been told that, meditation is the route to, like, it's the ultimate route to happiness and bliss. And now we are saying that people can become dependent on meditation, which tells me that in some cases it can even create a problem. So, can you explain that more?
So the thing is, there are different types of meditation, right? Now, what should I say? So classically, when someone says you should meditate, what is the first thing that comes to mind? What do we mean by meditate?
So I'll sit in a comfortable, relaxed position and probably play some music. some soothing music and become aware of what is going on in my mind.
And that's exactly what most people think about when it comes to meditation.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Do you know Osho in his research, if I'm not wrong, somewhere mentioned that there are 107 kinds of meditations that he was able to come across.
Oh.
And a meditation is supposed to be prescribed by a guru to a student based on the mental state of the student and the end objective that the student wants to achieve. It's not supposed to be an over-the-counter prescription.
Yeah, and if I'm not wrong, like I've heard this, that early on, you had to go to a guru. If the guru accepted you, they would kind of secretly share with you, you know, in your ear, a very, so this is my understanding of it, a very customized form of meditation or chanting. And you could do only that.
Yeah, but that's still one style of meditation. And we'll probably talk about it in some time right now. But what I'm talking about is that there are different types of meditation. Chanting is just one type. Right?
Correct.
And, okay, so let me break it down for you. So the way we look at it from the point of view of recommendations of meditations, we divide meditations in different categories. There can be an internal focus of attention meditation where your focus is driven inside. Right? And insight can either be on your thoughts, which is one kind of internal focus of attention meditation, or second, inside your body on the sensations that you are experiencing in the body. Right? So we can kind of break it down into thought-based meditations, body sensation-based meditations. Meditations can also be about external focus of attention, where you're literally focusing on something which is outside you.
Okay.
Right? So for example, when you sit and you look at a flower and you're literally able to notice every color, every shade in that flower, you're able to notice the petals, you're able to notice the shape, all of that, when you're noticing, you're literally mindful of that flower. Your complete focus of attention is over there, right? So that's an external focus of attention meditation. We are focusing on something outside you.
Like you are walking meditations and eating meditations, right?
Correct. And that becomes action-based meditations. Where I'm, my complete focus is on what I'm doing. It could be my walking. It could be my eating. It could be just my sitting at a particular place and noticing what's happening while I'm sitting. But not inside my body or inside my mind. But while I'm sitting, what's happening to the small movements that I'm making while I'm sitting in that posture.
Okay.
Right? Okay. And then you can have the chant-based meditations. Right? Now, one of the mistakes that a lot of us make is we believe that all meditations are equally good and they can be done by anyone at any point of time.
Yes, in fact, I think a lot of people keep experimenting with various types of meditations to see.
So, think about it this way. Let's say you are in a really negative state of mind right now. You have suicidal thoughts.
Okay.
And you are sitting and meditating on your thoughts. What will happen?
Oh my God. I'm probably going to make it so big that even if it's, I was not going to do it, I may now actually seriously start considering doing it.
Because your focus is completely on those thoughts which are telling you that you need to commit suicide.
Yeah. And correct. Correct. Or they may get stuck in my head.
Correct. Imagine if you're depressed. Actually, don't imagine you're depressed. Imagine someone else is depressed and they are the ones who are doing that meditation. Right? Now, when they are depressed, don't they have a lot of negative thoughts playing in their head?
Yes, already.
And I understand people saying that when you meditate, you need to learn to witness the thought. You know, while people are depressed, it's easier said than done. Any good anti-depression center would first stop any kind of self-analysis.
Right.
So now, is thought-based meditation always good?
No, not at all.
right? And sadly, people prescribe meditation left, right, and center, not even realizing what this can do to people. And again, to be fair, I'm only talking about thought-based meditations. There are other kinds of meditations which are, in cases where you're in a negative state, are safer. But when, for example, when I got into this field and when people would tell me, Nitin, meditate, and I would ask them, what do you mean by meditate? People who would recommend meditation had no answer what they meant by meditation. They said, kuch nahi, music chalo karke, aag band karke, baith jao, you will be aware of things that are happening inside you.
That is what I said.
Precisely. But that is actually dangerous. And that's one of the reasons why you will notice so many people get addicted to spiritual groups.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Right? Because while they are meditating, over a period of time, all those thoughts sink into their unconscious. So consciously, they become calmer. But because all of those thoughts have gone into the unconscious going forward, because unconscious controls a lot of our automatic responses, our thoughts, our emotions, your thoughts and emotions or actions are driven by a lot of those negative thoughts that you have allowed to sink into the system. And again, at this point, I'm only talking about thought-based meditation.
But you won't know because outwardly, you will feel lighter and calmer.
While you are doing the meditation. But you will notice over a period of time that if you don't meditate, then that lightness, that calmness is not sustainable. In fact, your need to meditate keeps increasing. See, there's one. I'm meditating because I like doing it. Even if I don't do it, it's okay. It doesn't really come in the way of my life. Right. But I enjoy doing it, so I'm doing it. And the second one that I have to do it because if I don't do it, I start getting, well, anxious, I start worrying, I start having a lot of problems.
It's the, like saying, aaj meditation nahi hui, toh aaj mood kharab hai.
Correct. Right? So that's what we are talking about. Now that's thought-based meditation. So when you are in an extremely negative state of mind, even when you want to let go of something, while you are feeling the emotion, thought-based meditation is not a very good idea.
Okay. All right.
Then is the chant-based meditations. Right? Now, when it comes to chanting, ideally speaking, the purpose of chant is this. That once you start chanting, your conscious mind is consumed by the chant. You kind of distract yourself away from all those negative thoughts that you were having earlier. And they kind of get pushed out of your mind. Okay. And then when you keep chanting, the chanting guides you into a state where you're more in touch with your unconscious. And because each chant has its own vibrations, those vibrations can create the required positivity in you.
Okay.
Right. So compared to thought-based meditations, when in a negative state, chant-based meditations are more preferable. But only if when you chant, your complete focus is on the chant. Now, what I've noticed with a lot of people is when they're chanting, the chant happens on an autopilot. But in the mind, they're still thinking, kal to usko bataunga jaake ki kya kiya usne. Or how can my boss do this to me? Right? Now, in that case, because the chant is happening on autopilot, the chant will still take you to the unconscious state. But with that, you will take all the negative thoughts that you're thinking about. So if while chanting, you can completely focus on the chant, then chanting is a good meditation to do when you're in a negative state. But if you're not able to do it, and that's rare for people to be able to do it. Generally, people would say that, you know, we again get kind of stuck in that thought pattern even while we are chanting. And in that case, better for people to avoid chant-based meditation also. Then we have the external focus of attention meditation. Right? Now, external focus of attention meditation are probably the safest form of meditation when you are in a negative state of mind.
Okay.
Because when you are doing something physical, a part of your awareness can shift to that physical activity any which way. And then you can make you can literally verbalize what you are doing to ensure that your focus remains on that activity. And that's the reason why when you start becoming mindful of the activities that you are doing, your mind becomes free from the clutches of those negative thoughts that you had earlier. Right? And once you are free, then obviously it becomes easier for you to carry on.
True.
Right?
Perfect.
And then we talk about eating, sleeping, walking, meditation, and so on. And if your focus can be on those activities, they are good meditation. But if you keep getting sucked into the negative thought pattern, then probably avoid them too. This is when you're in a negative state. But when you are in an extremely positive state, thought-based meditations are the best kind of meditations you can do for yourself.
Okay. Okay.
Right? So, because those meditations, the thought-based meditation kind of magnifies the feeling that you are in.
Right. So how you're feeling is like the best indicator of what kind of meditation you should choose.
Correct. So if you're feeling positive, choose a thought-based meditation. If you are feeling negative, then choose the external focus of attention meditation. And external focus of attention could simply be reading a book that you love reading. See, remember, meditation is about a state of awareness. When you're completely aware of something, you're actually in a meditative state. So don't try to do something which is fancy because people are asking you to do it. Do something in that moment which really makes you feel comfortable that you can completely focus on. And then you can move to something else that you want to do.
All right. Makes sense. True. Makes complete sense. So that was like a very, very clear understanding of, what meditations are good for you and what problems a wrong meditation can create. But as we discussed that meditations and about meditations and a lot of people being addicted to meditations and spiritual groups as well. So how come spiritual groups don't understand this?
So there are two possibilities. Mm-hmm. And both possibilities are based on the assumption that the spiritual groups have their heart in the right place.
Yeah.
Okay. So the first possibility is that they are actually not aware of it. But that would really worry me. Because most spiritual groups keep talking about awareness. And if they're not aware of something which is so blatantly visible as a part of their spiritual groups, then I'm not sure what awareness are they talking about. And that would kind of worry me. The alternate is they are aware, but they're not sure what to do about it. And because their heart is in the right place, they realize they're playing with percentages. That if it can help a percentage of people, that's better than not being able to help anyone.
Okay.
Now, the reason why, and the reason I said that they don't know why this is happening, and that's probably the reason why this keeps happening over and over again, is because spiritual groups, people who do meditations in them are not really trained in the working of mind. See, imagine, how does a particular person start doing meditation? Most people, I'm sure you know of people around you in the field that you are in who are using meditation, who either are running meditations for other people or maybe a part of spiritual groups, and they are now on their journey towards becoming one of the teachers as a part of those journeys.
Yes, so many.
Right? And when you ask them, they would actually tell you that my guru taught me the meditation and I'm doing the meditation.
Yes.
If you actually ask them, what does this meditation do for people? They will probably be able to give you a generic answer that it relaxes you, it makes you feel calmer, it helps you connect to yourself. But these are like all very vague answers. But when you actually ask them, how is it that people are getting addicted to certain kinds of meditation? They don't have an answer. And they don't have an answer because they're not trained in that field.
In the field of understanding the mind and all,
how the mind really works and how certain words, certain expressions, certain suggestions can make a lot of difference in the way people think, how the mental states can get influenced by certain thoughts, and how your thoughts can influence your mental states, which basically means that you have to be careful about which meditation are you choosing where.
But don't some spiritual groups today talk about the mind?
The transition towards mind or spiritual groups is a new transition. If you notice, till few years back, most spiritual groups will only talk about soul. and they would actually say mind is the root cause of all problems.
Oh yes. Ah.
And all of a sudden there's been this transition where now people are talking about mind and managing thoughts and managing emotions and all of these things. Right. Earlier the idea was meditate, you will get connected to your internal self, you will be able to become one with your soul, and then everything falls into place.
Oh, you are right. Yes, we never realized this. Yes. In fact, they used to say man bada chanchal hai, and man is the root cause of all suffering, and Atma is the one which will take you to God. Oh my God, never realized this.
Correct. And the transition is probably happening because a lot of spiritual groups have started realizing that what they were doing earlier in terms of meditation is not working. And that's the reason why people still need to be taught to manage their thoughts and emotions. And that's where the transition is happening. So the transition is a good transition because that actually shows to us that a lot of these spiritual groups are at least aware of what probably is going wrong with some of the practices.
True.
But I'm still not sure if they have the required understanding of how the mind works. And see, truly, while we are talking about this, to say that we have all the understanding of how the mind works is also going to be, we are stretching it a bit too far. Okay. Mind is incredibly vast. I don't really think there's anyone who knows completely everything about the mind. Be it me, be it anyone else. But there's still the basics that we need to understand in terms of how the unconscious is working. I don't think that understanding is there in terms of most people who run meditations in spiritual groups.
Right.
And then we obviously have certain spiritual gurus who have a tendency to talk about things that they have no idea about. But then, well, there are a few of them. I'm sure most of them have their heart at the right place.
Yeah, Nitin. There are a lot of spiritual groups which are doing some good work, really good work. So I think we need to be, I mean, we believe that the heart is in the right place. But so what should they do about this people getting addicted and...
So before, I know of a couple of groups who actually have a complete research wings and so on. That are trying to research on what can be done and how we can improve the situation. So again, when I'm saying this, please don't take it as a criticism to spiritual groups. I'm simply stating what is happening. And I'm sure some spiritual groups are trying to do the best that they can. But it's just also, so it's kind of, it's also an offer to help them. That if you're not sure what's happening, if you would like us to help you, please let us know. We'll be more than happy to have a set of people that have been trained by us who can actually understand what kind of meditations you are doing and be able to help you in terms of maybe streamlining those meditations or being able to create a process where you can understand which meditation can be suggested to what kind of people.
Oh, that would be probably like a win-win kind of a situation, right? And I'm sure... there are people, if there are people from spiritual groups out there listening to us, if you know someone, I'm sure they might connect with us. But what about forgiveness? That we haven't yet spoken about. And I'm sure you have something different to say about that as well. And since almost all religions talk about it, I hope you agree with the concept of forgiveness at least.
No, I do. I think the concept of forgiveness is amazing. It's a really, really powerful concept. If you're really able to understand it and put it into practice, it has complete potential to transform your life. Having said that, I'm not completely sure if I'm convinced about the process of forgiveness that people run.
I was waiting for this. Yes. I was almost expecting this. Anyways, please go ahead.
So the reason I say that is because in most forgiveness processes today, they're actually like letting go processes, right? And they suffer from the same limitations of letting go that we spoke about earlier. In fact, with forgiveness, there is at times an additional problem that takes place in the way the processes run. So I'm not talking about forgiveness as a concept right now, okay? But I'm talking about most processes. So you will notice most forgiveness processes are where you will go sit in a meditative state, you will be taken into a meditative trance or a hypnotic trance, whichever name you want to give it. And then eventually you will be asked to help people let go of what they're experiencing towards certain set of people. They will be able to express themselves, talk about their problems to those people. And eventually they feel lighter because they think they've forgiven the other person.
Yes, yes.
Right?
Correct.
And people do feel lighter at the end of the forgiveness processes and letting go processes. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. The problem is, if they are forgiving people who are still a part of their life and the situation is an ongoing situation, you will notice the same thing. You're sitting in another forgiveness process in another 2 months, forgiving the same person for the same reason.
Oh.
And this can happen after every 2.5 months, where you will find the same set of people attending multiple forgiveness programs. In fact, you know, there is a term for it, spiritual shopping, where we end up attending every trainer's spiritual program, which is talking about letting go and catharsis and forgiveness, because we feel maybe this is the one that will help me eventually forgive and let go.
So those processes are still like painkillers, right?
They are painkillers, and they are painkillers because you've still not learned the fact that we need to learn to cope up with that situation. There is someone, there is a person, or there is a situation that is an ongoing situation in my life. Now, the other problem with forgiveness is that the moment I think I have to forgive someone, okay, tell me, why would you forgive someone?
Because they have done something wrong to us, by us.
Correct. Which means in your head, you're convinced that they are the ones who have done something wrong?
Yes.
Where is your responsibility in that? We have happily escaped our responsibility from the entire situation.
That was a big
I would
one.
Not learn from that. So which means I would not learn from that situation in my life. And if I don't learn from it, the chances that the situation will repeat itself in future is very high.
True. So I haven't thought about my role that I played in the entire scenario, right?
Correct. At the end of the day, I was also part of that situation, wasn't I? And if I was a part of that situation, then how can I have no responsibility at all in that situation? Maybe the other person may have initiated something. But the fact that I was not able to handle it, I was not able to take care of the situation from my point of view. Or I allowed myself to be in that situation.
True.
Imagine if I was in a situation where a friend of mine came and told me that let's start a business together. I trusted him so much that I signed the papers without reading the papers. In those papers, there was a clause that my friend used after 4 years where we worked very hard. And once the company became very profitable, because of the clause, that friend threw me out of the company.
Oh,
I lost everything overnight. Right? Now I'm angry with him. Right? And because of that anger, it will start creating. Remember, we spoke about breakdown. It eventually can create a breakdown for me. So guru comes in, I speak to a guru, and that guru tells me that Nitin, anger is that burning coal which if you hold in your hand will only burn your hand. You need to just let go of it. And the metaphor makes sense.
Yes.
Right? So what do? I ask the guru, what do I do? And the guru says that all right, said, and then he or she makes me go through a process where I invite that person and I completely express everything that I wanted to express, and I eventually tell them that I've forgiven you. And I also release my emotions associated to that. Right? Now that I have forgiven the friend, another friend comes and tells me that let's start a business together. What do I do now? Do I do the business? Do I not do the business? If I decide not to do the business, then maybe I have not forgiven the earlier person. And if I decide to do the business, then I may end up making the same mistake again because I have actually not learned from it.
Correct. Makes perfect sense.
Right. And that's the reason why you will notice that generally people end up having these patterns where they have to forgive people because they don't realize that they are equally a part of the pattern.
Yeah.
And then the next problem with forgiveness that takes place at times is that people start getting an ego kick out of forgiveness. Have you come across people who tell you that, you know, I have forgiven so many people in my life? And they're proud of the fact that people have done so much wrong to them and they've forgiven them.
like I am the bigger, better person.
Correct.
True.
Right? Mm-hmm. Now, the problem with that is that feeling that I'm the bigger, better person is a short-lived ego kick that I'm getting. But that ego kick I'm getting out of forgiving someone. Now that ego kick is short-lived, so at some point that ego kick will go away and I'll come back to the ground. Now I want to experience that ego kick again. And I can only experience it when I forgive someone. So before I can experience that ego kick, I now have to put myself in a vulnerable position at an unconscious level so that someone can come and take advantage of me. Once they take advantage of me, then I can go through the process of forgiving them. And once I forgive them, then I can experience that ego kick again.
Wow. Wow. Just like when yesterday we were saying that if I believe that I'm always late, I'll not be able to find the keys lying right in front of me. So I'll end up making myself late somehow. Right?
Correct.
That's profound.
Correct. So in our understanding, and when we run forgiveness processes, and that's what we recommend to all our students also, that see, when you are, whether you are a therapist, whether you are a trainer, when you're working with people who have to forgive someone, you have to help them understand that eventually at some place they needed to learn something from their experience. At times the learning could simply be how to keep yourself safe, which is okay.
Yeah, correct.
There's still some learning that you can get out of that experience, and which also makes the person realize that to some extent, there was an element of responsibility that they could, again, not responsibility for the problem that took place, but responsibility for them not being able to handle the situation better.
True.
Right? Yes. And that also makes them feel more empowered going forward in future, because they realize that I'm in a position to actually not let this situation happen again in future.
True.
Right. And that is what we recommend, that when you're working with people, after you do the release process, always help them understand what was their role in the process, what is it that they can learn from it in future, if this situation were to take place, what skills do they require to be able to handle the situation better so that the end result is not the same. And to actually see them, and to actually help them see themselves applying these things in their future. It could simply be in terms of imagination or visualization.
Okay.
But let them imagine that. Let them have that realization that yes, we are able to handle situations better in future.
Right. So letting go is only like the first step.
Correct.
And then you look back and reassess and find out the learning, and second, once you've identified the learning, then what skills and mental states will help you deal with that thing going forward, right?
And apply that learning in future.
Right. That makes sense, Nitin. Forgiveness, letting go, meditation, so whatever we spoke about. And while all our episodes have been like, what should I say? It is cliched, but transformational. This one discussion has made me see, you know, forgiveness, spirituality in a brand new light, if I can say that. Right? But see, again, what would you...
Just to summarize, because at times when we have these discussions and way, generally I have a tendency to talk about some of these things, it comes across as that we are being critical of spiritual groups. So it's just that I would like to just remind you again that the idea is not that we want to be critical of spiritual groups. As I said, I genuinely hope and believe that their heart is at the right place. But what's happening needs to be addressed, and it needs to be brought into focus. The number of people who are also getting jacked because of simply the idea of meditation and not understanding what all is happening with them in the process is humongous.
True. True. I'm sure anyone who's listening, if you are one of those groups, or if you know someone, probably you can share this interview with them or help them get in touch with us. And, you know, we can carry this forward. We can talk about it. We can discuss and, you know, find out ways to help people. Good.
And Nitin, we are very open. And we are very open to the idea that if you have some of your meditations where you're realizing that certain people in your groups are showing counterindications because of those meditations, and some people are getting good results in them, and you would want us to go through them to help you understand probably how you can tweak them or how you can understand what people should go through, what processes, please let us know. And we'll be more than happy to help you with the same.
Perfect. And Nitin, what about, so for example, if I need to forgive someone and I've tried doing whatever you told me, but I can't do on my own, or I'm stuck in the process somewhere. So what can I do then?
So, all right. So if it's an ongoing situation, begin with the thoughts and manage thoughts and emotion wala activities that we spoke about in that particular episode. Managing your thoughts and emotions should actually be quite useful for you. Situation which has happened in the past and it's not ongoing, then maybe to begin with, you may want to do some release meditation, or if you're a part of spiritual group or something where they do certain catharsis activity, you may want to be a part of that and try if that helps you. But if you feel that's not working, then please go and visit a therapist.
Okay. Yeah,
I'm assuming the therapist would be in a far better position to help you deal with those situations. But most therapists ideally would understand at least what we're talking about.
Perfect.
And please don't try to use meditation, self-meditation, as a process for releasing intense negative emotions which are stored in your system.
Right. So self-meditation is as bad as self-medication, guys. Don't do it. Please find an expert and seek help before you go forward, especially if you're seeing something that you did not want. So like, as Nitin said, a counterindication. So if you're, if you're seeing yourself becoming dependent on it, or if the day you're not able to do it, you feel bad and your entire day goes topsy-turvy, then that is probably a sign that you need to find out what's going on, right?
True. And we were talking about meditations, and you're in a negative state. Huh? When you're in a positive state, when you're happy, please go ahead and enjoy your way to meditations. They can be really, really useful and they can really be life-changing.
Perfect. So, Nitin, those were some excellent insights, I must say. I think I say them at the end of every episode, but I can't help saying that. And that said, as you said, many people, meditation can be used for developing like a positive bent of mind or positive attitude, positive thinking. And now people are also talking about how positive thinking can help you attract what you want in your life. So I would love to hear your thoughts on that, how positive thinking works, what can it do for us, and how can we actually become positive in our lives. So I think that is what we are going to talk about tomorrow.
Correct. So tomorrow's complete episode is dedicated to positive thinking and why it works, why it doesn't work, what can you do to make it work for you, and what are the loopholes that you need to be careful about when you're applying what is popularly known as positive thinking nowadays. Right. So, and tomorrow would be a lot of fun because we'll again look at, we will look at certain processes, certain techniques, and we will also have certain discussions which can change the way you look about, you think about secret law of attraction, positive thinking, and a lot of new concepts.
Wonderful. So already looking forward to it. 23 hours to go and the countdown has already begun. So that is what tomorrow's episode of True Talks is about, positive thinking and what can you do to be positive and how can it help you. So stay tuned in 5:30 p.m. every day, FB Live, and share it with your friends so that more and more people can benefit about it. Plus, Nitin has been sharing with us every day how iChar Support Foundation has begun a lot of initiatives during this time, especially around this time and otherwise. And especially there is this support group, right, Nitin, on managing COVID anxiety, COVID-related anxiety.
Correct. So every Monday and Thursday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., we have a COVID anxiety support group where we help people manage their anxiety and help them deal with whatever other questions or challenges they are facing during this time of lockdown. We also have a support group for LGBTQI plus community that we have every Wednesday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. If you go to the ICHR Support Foundation website, you will probably be able to find all these details. Also on the FB page, you would be able to find many details about these initiatives that we have. And all of these initiatives are free. So if you would like to be a part of these initiatives, if you know of people who are suffering from anxiety, or if you know of people having any other issues because of COVID-19 in terms of mental health, and you would like us to initiate another initiative, please let us know and we'll be more than happy to see what we can do about this.
Perfect. So I'll just mention the websites once again. It is www.ichars.foundation, or you can look up ICHAR Support Foundation on the internet. And see you tomorrow, everyone. Same time with another episode of True Talks. Same time, 5:30 p.m. FB Live. Thank you, Nitin, for being with us. Thank you for answering all those questions.
Thank you. Bye-bye.